May it please the court, Rebecca Garverman for appellants. I'd like to reserve 3 minutes. I'll begin by addressing the 3 points requested by this court. First, my clients are willing to engage in mediation and have been willing to do so since we were contacted by this court's mediation program in May. We have conferred with counsel for the government, who has informed us that the Park Service is not willing to mediate our claims. Consequently, submission of this case should not be deferred. While we would have been willing to allow for the exhaustion of mediation, we do not believe that this court should defer in the absence of any mediation. The Park Service has continued to insist that their proposed revision of the General Management Plan via the Tamales Point Area Plan is purely discretionary. This effort could be delayed or abandoned at any time. This is why we have emphasized in our briefing that the case is not moot, as we need a declaratory judgment confirming that the Park Service has a mandatory duty to revise the General Management Plan, as well as a court order holding the Park Service to a schedule to do so.
Well, here's my concern, and maybe it's an irrelevant concern. I want to ask the government about this, too. The case is not moot. I don't think anybody claims the case is moot. It normally takes us several months in difficult cases to come up with opinions. It may take us longer. And if the plan is revised in the meantime, it does become moot, correct? Revision is all you're seeking. It's not a sub... You could later attack the substance of the revision, but right now your only claim is that they have to revise.
Correct, Your Honor. However, we do not believe the case would be moot because voluntary cessation of unlawful action does not moot a case.
That's where I have some difficulty. Let's assume that they revised it today. Again, put aside the substance of the revision. We're talking here about the Point Reyes. We're not talking about their general practices around the country. We're talking about the Point Reyes general management plan. Can you really make a case that that's capable of repetition yet evading review? I mean, if they wait very long to revise it again, you come into us and you tell us, and we deal with it. So one of my difficulties with the case, because you're not guaranteed a victory, is maybe you're better off with us waiting than us ruling.
Well, Your Honor, if we come to you again, we are stuck with the district court ruling that there is no mandatory duty. So we couldn't come to you again in the future if there was another unreasonable delay. So I would say that this is capable of repetition. And the Park Service has repeatedly said that while they are going to revise the general management plan, they do not believe that it is anything other than a discretionary duty for them to do so.
So tell me why it's not just a discretionary duty. And I think you need to deal with me with all the acronyms bother me, the ONRC case.
Absolutely, Your Honor. So this case is governed, first of all, by Southern Utah Wilderness Association versus Norton, where the Supreme Court provided that a claim under 706.1 can proceed only where a plaintiff asserts an agency failed to take a discrete agency action that it is required to take. And so here you have exactly that. 54 U.S.C. Section 100.502 directs that the general management plans for the preservation and use of each system unit shall be prepared and revised in a timely manner by the director.
How is revision a discrete action? I mean, there could be an infinite or, in some cases, no revisions required under particular plans.
Well, Your Honor, revision is a discrete action because it's just updating a single document. And I would also note that the government has actually conceded that the statute imposes a discrete duty to revise the plans. And so the only remaining question is whether the duty imposed is mandatory.
Well, whether it's mandatory and both as to execution and as to time.
Correct, Your Honor. Correct?
So tell me why it's mandatory as to time.
So, Your Honor, it's not that it has to be mandatory as to time. It's that it has to be mandatory as to whether the action must be done. And so here, it is very clear that the Park Service must revise the general management plan. You are correct. There is some initial discretion in the timing of when, but whether they must revise the plan is mandatory. There is no discretion there. And Your Honor had mentioned the ONRC case. The Park Service's position that the language in a timely manner somehow converts an otherwise mandatory duty to a discretionary one is just incorrect. The government relies heavily on ONRC, and that case does not apply here. The language in the statute at issue in ONRC directs the agency to revise land use plans when appropriate, and that is materially different from the statute here.
Why is that materially different in a timely manner? When appropriate means at the time when it is appropriate to do so. In a timely manner means when it is timely to do so. Why are they so different?
Your Honor, respectfully, I disagree. If the statute had said when timely, then perhaps these two statutes would have very similar language. It doesn't. The statute says revisions must be done in a timely manner. And as you correctly point out, when appropriate indicates there could be a time when it is never appropriate to revise.
Well, couldn't it also indicate that when timely?
But it is not when timely. It is in a timely manner. And that indicates that something must be done, but must be done in a timely manner. The government must revise the general management plan, and when they do so is in a timely manner. It is a condition that reinforces the mandatory duty. So the mandatory duty exists, and Congress also wanted the Park Service to do it without undue delay. And so they added the language in a timely manner.
Did they revise it in 2021?
No, Your Honor. They revised the general management plan only as it pertained to the rest of Point Reyes National Seashore.
And where is that in the statute? I guess this is a problem for you, isn't it, that they have revised it. They just haven't revised the substantive part that you want to talk about, which does suggest that you're asking us to impose a substantive gloss over a procedural statute here. Why doesn't that revision count?
Because that revision does not, that revision specifically excluded, to Molly's point.
So could you have challenged that revision and said it's arbitrary and capricious because you didn't deal with another important part of the problem?
Perhaps we could have, Your Honor.
I'm trying to, as Judge Johnstone's question sort of leads me to whether or not what you're claiming today is not that they haven't revised the plan in a timely manner, but that the way they revised it in 2021 was insufficient to address the problem that you're now raising. And that seems to me to be a arbitrary and capricious attack rather than a timeliness attack.
Well, Your Honor, it's not so much that they revised the plan in a way that we didn't like. It's that they didn't revise the plan at all as it pertains to the Tamales Point area.
But isn't your point that they should have revised it in 2021 to deal with the very problem? When did you bring this lawsuit?
Your Honor, I am not actually sure.
I mean,
sure when
about
then,
nothing gets up here immediately.
But I can.
You could have said in this lawsuit, wait a minute, when you revised it in 2021, you should have dealt with the whole problem, not just the cattle ranchers' problem.
We could have, Your Honor. And when we brought this lawsuit, we didn't intervene in the Resource Renewal Institute lawsuit because we were concerned about the elk. The elk at Tamales Point have been suffering. They have died. They were unable to access food and water during drought starting in 2013. And our plaintiffs were witnessing emaciated, suffering, dying elk as a result of the droughts. And our desire was to ensure that there was relief brought to those elk, and we believed that doing so would be best remedied by bringing a separate suit for emergency relief, and thus intervening in the ongoing resource renewal suit would not have addressed our immediate concerns and provided relief for the elk.
Could you have filed a petition with the agency for revision of the
as a petition for a writ of mandamus?
No, a petition with the agency. An application to the agency to have it revise the plan.
Your Honor,
The reason I ask this is I'm looking at most of the cases you cite that deal with mandatory duty are 555 cases where somebody has gone to the agency and said, I'd like you to do something. And the agency says no. And then people come to us and say, they violated their duty under 555 to respond to the agent to the request. I'm trying to figure out whether there was another procedural mechanism for you to use here.
It's possible, Your Honor, but there are two reasons why we wouldn't want to do that. One is that this is an unreasonable delay case. So by bringing a petition, that would just subject us to further delay. The elk would continue to suffer and die while the agency had time to decide on the petition, thereby just allowing more time to elapse before the wildlife got any relief. The second is that we just felt we didn't need to. There is a clear statutory duty under here, so we can bring a Section 706.1 an APA claim and obtain relief under that unreasonable delay claim. And Your Honor, just to go back to ONRC, you know, as I mentioned, when appropriate indicates the duty is obviously discretionary. In a timely manner means the Park Service must get this done. And
well, for whom? Because right after the language that we've been focused on, there is a timely, regular reporting requirement. But that's to Congress. So why shouldn't we read this as an instruction to the agency to keep Congress up to date? Congress, through its oversight duties, might be better positioned to decide what is or isn't timely with regard to particular plans.
Well, Your Honor, that's a separate duty. They do have to just update Congress on the status of general management plans and the status of their revisions. It's a separate duty to actually engage in the revision itself, and that is what the Park Service has failed to do. And as to what is timely, the Park Service themselves have actually said what that means. In their policies, they have said that general management plans should be reviewed every 10 to 15 years, and that if substantial changes in conditions have occurred, the plans should be revised even sooner. And here we
have...
That
policy, you believe that policy is enforceable here?
I believe that policy is not binding. I believe that policy is very important for the court to take into account when determining what timely means, which really should be in the second prong. That should be the unreasonable delay analysis, not the mandatory duty. The mandatory duty exists, then the question about what is timely is governed by the track factors and is the unreasonable delay analysis. And here, in accordance with Southern Utah Wilderness Association, the manner of the agency's action is left to their discretion, but whether they must act is not a question of discretion. They must revise these plans.
But you're arguing that the time at which they must act is not subject to discretion in this case either.
The time, initially, they have some discretion to determine the time, and when they unreasonably delay, as they have here for over 44 years, it then falls to a court to decide whether that delay is reasonable, and that is why we brought this case. And as Judge Armstrong of the Northern District of California correctly held in the resource renewal case, the Park Service has a mandatory statutory duty. And now the government has argued that a mandatory duty cannot be imposed by a statute absent a clear timeline. This is clearly wrong and not in accordance with this court's precedent. And we have also relied on Section 555B of the APA, cases that invoke that, because that section says that agencies must proceed to conclude a matter presented to them.
And that's why I asked you about 555. It seems to me it's quite clear that if you go to an agency and say, please do something, and it doesn't respond it has to respond under 555 in some way. You didn't do that here. You didn't petition the agency to do something. You came directly to us.
Correct.
And said, you tell them to do something. And isn't that a difference between the 555 cases?
I see I'm running short, but if I can just sure. quickly answer Your Honor's question. The difference is that Section 555B, while a different procedural posture, that section imposes a mandatory duty. It says each agency shall proceed to conclude a matter presented to it within a reasonable time. And within a reasonable time is strikingly similar to in a timely manner. And so if 555B imposes a mandatory duty, then surely 54 U.S.C. 100-502 does as well. If there are no further questions, I would like to reserve the remainder of my time. And if that is all right?
Yes. Yeah, we'll give you 2 minutes.
Thank you so much, Your Honor.
Yes. Thank you, Ms. Garverman. Mr. DeVito.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the Court. David DeVito from the U.S. Attorney's Office for the Northern District of California on behalf of the Appalachians. I'd like to begin by addressing the questions that the Court put out to the parties. And my colleague correctly noted that the Park Service does not believe that a mediation would be a productive use of time and resources at this juncture as the Park Service moves forward with its planning efforts.
What's your timeline? When will we see the revision?
Your Honor, the revised plan will be finalized by the end of August. So in terms of timeline, the Park Service will issue the environmental assessment in May and will finalize the revised plan in August. So turning into the court's question about an appropriate period for deferral, we do, recognizing the court's interest in judicial efficiency, think that a period of deferral would be appropriate, and we would propose that period be sufficient to encompass the Park Service issuing the plan or approving the plan by the end of August.
Yeah, I take it the reason that you don't think mediation would be useful is that you're doing a plan, and that all the mediation would do is end up with you agreeing to do a plan.
That's correct, Your Honor. We're very close to finalizing the plan. We're now very far down the road of doing that after having announced the intent to do it in December 2021. Several years later, we're on the cusp of finalizing the plan, so a mediation we just don't think would be productive in terms of what we would do. What we would do there would be agreeing to things that we're already doing and, in fact, have almost completed.
Turning to merits, can you wait forever to revise a plan?
The Park Service has an obligation to revise the plan.
And is that judicially enforceable?
No, it's not.
So even though you have the obligation, let's assume you just said thanks, but no thanks. We're busy with other stuff. We're never going to revise this plan because we haven't been funded well enough, or because we care about other park plans more than this one, or whatever. Park Service made that clear. We couldn't order it to revise the plan.
Applying the court's analysis in SUA, the answer to that, Your Honor, is that no, because it's not that statute, the GMP statute, does not create an obligation that's enforceable under 706.1.
So why did Congress pass it at all then?
Well, the origin of the statute, of course, obligated the Park Service to create general management plans in the first place.
Right, but there's also a provision that says they shall be revised in a timely manner. You're effectively reading that out of the statute, aren't you?
No, not at all, Your Honor. The Park Service absolutely has an obligation to revise the plan.
Just not a judicially enforceable one.
Correct.
Well, why does it even have an obligation to prepare them? I mean, I don't read in a timely manner as necessarily modifying, only revised. So prepared in a timely manner. So they create the particular area governed by FLIPMA, and you sit on it before even preparing. Could you do that for 40 years?
Don't think so. But in terms of looking to the courts, the analysis that the Supreme Court says is required under SUA, the issue is this a statute that creates an obligation about which the agency has no discretion whatever? And in order to get there, you have to eliminate the Park Service's discretion, and we think that the conferral of discretion in the statute is pretty clear.
Well, I think your friends on the other side would say, yeah, there's discretion. There's maybe 10 to 15 years of discretion. There's not 40.
Well, the 10 to 15 years that they're coming up with is from the Park Service's own policy documents, and what those policy documents say is that the Park Service will review its plans in a 10 to 15 year time period. That's the suggested time period to determine whether they need to be revised. Review and revise are not equivalent, and so that assessment is a general policy guidance that the Park Service applies to itself. But just looking at that, it shows you the amount of discretion that the statute confers, right? And because it confers that discretion, it's outside the scope of 7061 under SUA.
Has the department reviewed its, so it hasn't revised it, has the department reviewed the status of the ELK for purposes of deciding at any earlier point whether it should revise the plan?
Well, as we are here today, as your honors know, the Park Service has not only reviewed, but has made the determination that it is appropriate to revise the plan.
And what was the precipitating factor there, this litigation?
No, Your Honor. The precipitating factor was the historic droughts that occurred over the last decade, both in terms of severity and duration. And a host of other factors, of course, go into whether a plan revision is appropriate in a given case based on the factors that are enumerated in the statute. Those things happen to coincide, but the Park Service's determination that it is appropriate to do that was driven by the impacts of those droughts on the resources in the park.
Well, you do agree, don't you, that the statute provides a mandatory duty to revise the plan at some point? Let's assume that in a timely manner was left off at the end and just said, shall revise the plan.
I still think that that's probably a discretion-conferring statute under the circumstances. Looking at...
Said revise the plan every 5 years, would it be a mandatory duty?
If it was mandatory both as to whether and when, I think that's probably...
Well, I tried to make it mandatory.
Well, that's what SUA that's exactly what SUA says, right?
If it said shall revise every 5 years, is it mandatory as to whether and when?
I think so, yes. And I think that that's very much like...
But you get to decide. But because the word timely is there rather than every 5 years, your view is that it's a discretion. It's thereby turned into a discretionary statute, not a mandatory one.
Absolutely, Your Honor. Considering the context and the purpose of this statute, which requires the revision of general management plans for all of the units in the Park Service, and there are hundreds, and it seems clear that Congress intentionally inserted that
Congress put that there because it wasn't going to impose on you a specific timeline. But your position seems to be that we don't even have to do it in a fashion that everybody in the world would agree was timely, because you didn't tell us when.
Well, that's sort of what SUA says, right? It says that unless the statute, and we're here because, as Your Honor correctly pointed out, we're not in the situation where there was a petition for a rulemaking or something that a particular party came to the Park Service and asked. So that's why under SUA we have to look at the law that they're citing and determine whether that creates this mandatory, non-discretionary duty. And
could they petition to have you revise the GMP?
I don't know the answer to that, Your Honor.
Well, why could they? Because I think according to your argument, within a reasonable time to proceed to conclude a matter, the petition would have to be to have you revise the plan in a timely manner, which I think your argument is that you couldn't.
Well, would a petition? Right. Argument is that the decision about when to do that is intentionally discretionary with the Park Service, and that the Park Service has the expertise to know when to do that.
But you'd have
charged
to,
with the obligation.
Assuming that such a petition would lie, you'd have to respond to that petition within a reasonable time.
Sure, right? Then we'd be in
and
a
if
different
you didn't, if
procedural
you didn't,
posture.
Our case law says that's an enforceable duty to make you do so in a reasonable time. Even though the reasonable time language is not very specific.
Correct. Then you'd be under doing a different analysis under 555.
Right. So now I'm channeling your friend here. She says, well, since you can enforce that in a reasonable time language in the statute, why can't we enforce the in a timely manner language in the statute?
Well, precisely because they're different, and 555B is in the APA itself, and it's clear that under 555B, the purpose of that is to require agencies to take action on particular things that are presented to them. And if they fail to do that, then that claim gets channeled. It does get channeled through 706, but it doesn't go through the SUA analysis, because the SUA analysis is particular to where we are here, where we're talking about what is otherwise an allegation that an agency has just not complied with some law that otherwise directs it to do something. And so that SUA requires that as sort of a gatekeeping analysis. Is that law that anywhere in the United States Code or in a regulation or wherever it happens to be found that someone's trying to enforce, does that impose a mandatory non-discretionary duty?
Well, setting aside the non-discretionary duty, which of course would be the trigger for our action, what's the agency's position on what timely manner refers to? Timely with respect to the last revision, timely with respect to its prepared, timely with respect to the policy circumstances over which the plan has coverage? What does timely manner, I mean, I assume you don't go into Congress, your client doesn't go into Congress every year and say, well, timely manner, they have to report. So what does timely manner refer to? Timely with respect to what?
Well, timely is what I think it was talking both about the initial general management plan and is also timely revision. But as Judge Hurwitz pointed out, what timely talks about essentially means when appropriate. And that's the conferral of discretion that we're talking about here.
Appropriate with respect to what? When the stars align? What?
Well, the criteria that are enumerated in the GMP statute. So talking about resource management, visitor capacity, things like that.
So if each of the four categories, considerations under the statute, let's say each of them, let's just put them on a quantitative scale, they each changed by 10 orders of magnitude. So big changes, just going to sea change with respect to the lands under the agency's management here. Does that change the timely manner analysis?
Certainly the degree to which those factors change over time is something that influences the Park Service's decision as to whether a revised plan is appropriate. Absolutely. But it also captures why the discretion exists, right? Because you can easily envision a scenario where those factors don't change at all for decades. And the units that the Park Service manages range from Yellowstone to some Rosie the Riveter. And you can, if you are looking at the factors that are enumerated in the GMP statute, you can easily imagine that those will be very different for all the different units within the park, and that's precisely why the Park Service has discretion to determine when. And so when the appellants say, well, the Park Service has to revise this regardless of whether it thinks it's appropriate to do so, we couldn't disagree more with that take on it. That the conferral of the discretion is there so that the Park Service is able to avoid judicial intervention in situations where the Park Service has no reason to believe it's appropriate to revise a plan and isn't just going through the...
Well, you've now decided it is appropriate to revise it, correct?
Correct, yes, we're on
and
the
what if you,
to revise
what
it.
If you, their fear is that you might decide in July that it's not appropriate to revise it. Could we enforce this duty then? Were you once having decided it was appropriate to revise it, and then you've said, the heck with it, we're not going to do it. Could we then enforce the duty?
Well, no, because the SUA analysis doesn't look to whether the agency has thought it was appropriate to do something and then changed its mind. I mean, the SUA analysis looks at the law and whether it confers discretion. And if it confers the discretion, then it's not enforceable under 706.1. I see that my time has expired, so thank you.
Thank you, Mr. DeVito. Ms. Garberman, we'll put 2 minutes on your clock and see how we do.
Thank you, Your Honors.
Counsel, I understand your argument about they've got a duty to revise the general management plan in a reasonable time or time manner. But in what way? Do they have to take specific actions because they have a duty to revise it? What if you don't like the actions they take?
If we don't like the actions they take, Your Honor, and we believe that they are unlawful, we can then bring an arbitrary and capricious claim. But right now, we are not claiming they must revise the plan in a particular manner. The manner, in accordance with SUA, is left up to the agency's discretion. It is just whether they must revise the plan that is mandatory and not discretionary.
So as counsel talked about, there are scenarios where things on the ground don't change much over time. And this is the case, I understand that you're talking about the droughts as being the precipitating, instigating factor. Is that it?
Your Honor, I believe that in any situation there would have to be some combination of changed conditions and time that has elapsed to determine in a timely manner and what that means. And here we have both of those things.
So is the larger elk population result of too much coddling? Not natural, or is the smaller elk population? Which one is this? Which one would be the default if the National Park Service wasn't on the ground, wasn't doing anything there?
Well, Your Honor,
because your argument is, well, the elk population has declined. Well, maybe it should if that's what the natural conditions would be.
Well, Your Honor, we can't really say because there aren't natural conditions. There's a miles-long, 8-foot-tall fence that prevents this herd from acting as though they are truly a wild herd. So in the wild, a herd would be able to migrate in times of drought. They'd be able to find new sources of food and water, and this herd is prevented from doing so.
Does the fence completely surround them?
Correct, Your Honor. Okay. It's a peninsula, okay. So the fence prevents them from migrating at all. And I'd just briefly like to make two quick points. One, as Judge Hurwitz correctly pointed out, the agency can delay or abandon their efforts at any time. In fact, they've already flip-flopped in their announcement to the public as to whether or not their current efforts will actually revise the general management plan. And also, their Park Service policies say that they should amend a GMP when significant changes in conditions have occurred, which is precisely the point here. Their own website states current management guidance for Tamales Point did not anticipate these drought conditions or consider climate change. So the general management plan, as it pertains to Tamales Point, has not been revised since 1980 and has not taken into account drastically changed conditions that has led to the death of hundreds of elk. Respectfully, we would request that this court reverse the district court's erroneous ruling and remand for further proceedings. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ms. Garberman, and thank you to counsel on both sides for your arguments. This case will be submitted.